Another great day is upon us. Another great episode of the King's Cast as well with Spectacular and DJ Naze. I get so excited about these moments.
Yeah.
Because we learn so much from our guests. It's always exciting. Like, especially the things about them that we just didn't know.
100%.
They come out in conversation. Things that you can't Google.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm more excited about today's guest because it's another one that we've been trying to get on the show for the longest time. Somebody like that really inspires me, that I can get lost in conversation with for hours.
Yeah.
And I'm privileged that she actually lets me do that from time to time. Who are we talking about? The queen of Itudjwa. Oh man, ever so amazing, ever so graceful, ever so impactful. Everything that she touches turns to platinum. Naves, you tell, because I can't say the name without paying. Every time you say this woman's name, you must pay something.
Now you want me to pay?
Yeah,
I don't.
Welcome to the show. What's good, mommy?
I'm the queen of Itudjwa.
Yeah, of course you are.
Do you know that?
Do you know that when we actually had to drive past there, driving from Emondi to from Mthatha to Emondi,
we needed to
stop. No, we needed to stop first and say, just there by the Itudjwa sign, and then carry on the way.
Yeah, I love that. You must give props where props is due.
You know what I'm saying?
Thank you for having me.
You're the last person to say that. Because we're in your neighborhood every single Monday, without a doubt.
But you know, I'm in study in Jona, so.
In study?
But I'm here. I'm here today. So that's.
And it's the same place. Right? So.
I made it up to you guys.
So thank you so much.
Yeah.
Appreciate you joining us.
Of course.
I'd like to go way back in time, right?
Sure.
I mean, like, I can just establish things around family and just what was in your mind back then? Because we know you as this dynamic force right now, but when you were that little girl that was a pastor's kid in Itudjwa, did you foresee any of this happening?
Well, one, umama usando ordena ngoku ebudaleni bethu. So when we grew up, it was they weren't playing that specific role in church. But I don't know that I had the full picture in mind. God didn't understand is that I would always work with people. Mm. I went through a stage where I thought I'd be a psychologist, and I thought, no, I don't think I'd be able to separate myself from people's challenges. And then I guess, you know, always just being open to learn and loving people. Mm. I was always sort of drawn to get to know the people that other people didn't think were cool.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know if that was projecting, because I always kind of felt I was a little bit outside of every circle I tried to be a part of.
Yeah.
And then at some stage, I just started embracing that I'm different. I do things my own way.
Yeah.
And I always learn. And funda ngabantu. That's always been a passion of mine. I think that's the consistency from childhood.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And now being that person who does things in your own unique way, how much more of, as a child, how much more of that made you an outcast?
Mm. Oh, that's a good one. I think I learned early on to repackage what most people will call rejection.
Yeah.
Just figure out a different way to do things.
Yeah.
And I think, I don't know if it was subconscious or where I kind of got that I wouldn't prioritize what other people thought about me as bigger than what I thought about myself.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was just the confidence I always saw in my mom and my dad's partnering relationship, because they could both play their parts without there ever being like a standoff. I'm sure they had standoffs in the bedroom or something where we couldn't see them. But I think that gave me kind of the confidence in that sense.
Mm. Okay. So I'd like to ask the next question in two parts.
Sure.
One is, like you spoke there, like about your personality as a child.
Yeah.
But as children, there's always someone that kind of injects that personality in us, whether it's a grandparent, a parent, an aunt or an uncle or a cousin, who played that role.
Gutata. Utata looked after me when I was still predominantly small, before I turned 3.
Yeah.
Because umama was still in school.
Right.
I love that he not let her, but supported her in finishing her
studies.
That's
amazing, especially for back then. Yeah.
So utata wayengumuntu othanda ibhola. So he would always take me to the pubs with him in my nappies. Eyobukela ibhola. So ndikhule ndise bantwini. And I think that just kind of cemented how I would be in and around abantu.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sure. And then, are you a mommy's girl or a daddy's girl?
now. It's changed. Yeah. Yeah. Because no one gets between me and my dad.
Right.
But my mom is my home girl. Like, okay. Yeah. I think I've been able to have conversations with her that I wasn't able to have before. And let me tell you, I'm instigating the difficult conversations. Because I've always had a challenge with us not being able to have that real conversation that you go, I need my mom's opinion on this, but without feeling judged by some of what I got to say. Because some of it is shocking to the system, right? Yes. So, yeah, I think I'm a lot closer to Umama in that sense. But my dad is my homie, like for real, for real.
I think I've become a parent to a girl.
Yes.
I now understand the saying, girls need their fathers a lot more than before. Because once you've sort of had a child and can connect with your daughter, you then get the picture why it's important for fathers to play a role.
That's interesting, because I remember even being a young girl and my father would say, Mntanam, if there's something you need, come and ask me.
Right.
Difuna ukufundisa the right way for you to get access to certain things.
Right.
I wouldn't want ukubana udibane nomntu akuqhathe. If there's an experience you want to have, come tell me, we'll make it happen. And come ask me.
Yeah.
And I value that kakhulu because in as much as, I mean, you're not going to be explicit in a conversation with your dad, but you know that homie rides for you.
Yeah.
And there are certain pivotal moments in my life where what my dad had to say actually changed the game in terms of how I perceived things.
Okay. Yeah.
One of the biggest, you know, pivoting moments was, you know, when the change in our family structure happened.
Yeah.
What my dad contributed to the conversation helped me get on my feet. And that was, I guess, amazing. Testament to our longstanding friendship and relationship throughout the years. Yeah.
Amazing.
Okay, so I'm loving that comment that you said earlier about you watching soccer in nappies in the tavern.
Yeah.
To me, that explains why whenever we are out here, you have the time of your life. It's your natural habitat. You grew up in that space.
Did you say the tavern is my natural habitat?
Wow, it's big.
As you try them in life, there's different kinds of talents. But at the end of the day, could I have a puzzle and a dice with trailer and a music? What else could be worse?
Maybe it's not too favorite Chiefs, so it could be worse.
Just answer the question. Just so we're not
always,
a treat you.
Always. Oh, that's never going to change.
Our relationship's so sad.
That's never going to change.
How do you feel?
I'm in therapy, but
I think you need to build them for the therapy at this stage because it's ongoing abuse.
Don't be like that, you guys. I thought we were playing nice.
I withdraw.
There's been much talk and much discussion, especially over various interviews around Miss Teen South Africa. What happened to getting us to Miss SA, to Miss World, Miss Universe? Why did you just stop there? We needed you to do it for your country.
I think I met you around that time.
We've known each other for long.
I sent you guys pictures actually of way back in the day, and I was like, you guys knew each other.
It's so crazy. And there was a particular situation.
Let's leave it.
Why are we leaving it? Come on, let's not leave it.
I'll be nice.
I'll give you the light story.
Yesterday,
we went out to a party.
Right.
I think you're going to say too much, though.
I won't.
Okay.
And we were inside the party having the time of our lives.
Right.
Unbeknown to me that my friend here, Ushie Umunde Modeni. So see, driver, gumnandi.
All night. Right.
So me, I'm like, okay, it's katsok vaya. I'm walking into the car.
I shouldn't have let you tell the story because that's not how it happened.
Okay, how did it happen?
But it was a bit crazy.
Yeah.
At that time, when it's time to leave, I'll let you know and then you can, you know. So I dealt with the wrath of uncle walking me to the car after this function.
Yeah.
Instead of walking out by your own at night and come on,
also because like kandine chomi akufuneka ngandifihle lonto. Like,
and I think from that day onwards, to this day, that guy dislikes me.
We won't mention. Let's leave it. Because it'll be crazy.
He's in the past anyway.
Yeah.
In the far past.
I'm always like caught in these things, like innocent bystander, like
innocent.
I don't think I don't think Joga, we attend the narrative.
Yeah.
Because how would you ask Kata Watungukiha at some stage? So we'll just
No, I didn't say that.
Okay.
I didn't say
what
that.
What did you say?
I posted a picture at a shoot pretending to be a doctor. Somebody took that and posted it on the internet.
And then you ran with it.
And said, no, and said congrats to Names for opening his own practice.
Yes.
Me, I was continuing on the paid posts I was doing. You know, that's not on me.
Okay. Why don't you say the person's name?
We don't name and shame. Yeah.
It's not naming and shaming.
Ah, because song can we've got files on each other.
Ish, then there's that.
We'll keep it tidy.
But you haven't answered my question.
What was your question?
Why didn't you take us further?
Oh, okay, yes, that was the question. Hey, so Pillars and Tetris and Disney means. You know what? Because I think originally the pageant world was not what I was deciding to participate in.
Okay.
It was just at that time I had a concern around the image that was portrayed for teenagers. We didn't have it picture perfect, nor have all the answers.
Right.
And so I just felt like something that's a little bit more relatable to us as SA teenagers in general kind of needed to be a part of the conversation. So that's how I got into that opportunity. And then as I progressed, I just realized, oh, wow, this thing is actually quite dope. It opened my entire career up in media, actually, because as a result of that, I got an opportunity to work with Urban Brew Studios. I stayed Payana. Then Oh Baby
Your
Joe
TV,
got
right?
in the mix, yes.
Yeah.
And then
from Cinema
Twins, then it was just crazy.
Was it actually like just Your TV?
Yeah,
or any
so it was we did the live shows.
Yeah.
I did a show with Akumzi as well, actually, which was always fun.
Yeah.
Such a great
clips.
Energy, right?
Do you have those clips?
I don't know. I haven't seen them in a long time.
And it's
like I'm this kind of girl.
Please do and share with me.
Then from there, you know, that's when I go Selima Tunzi with Okayos or Brown, and then everything else just happened.
Yeah.
So I don't think I felt like I needed that platform in that same way again because things were already happening in a different capacity for me.
Did you enjoy though your reign as Miss Teen?
It was awesome. It was really, really awesome. I think that was the first time I really got to have an experience where I was like, man, there's so much happening in South Africa.
Yeah.
There's so many ways to show up. There's so many ways to serve. One of the most interesting things I did actually was work in a prisons program.
Mm.
So with juvenile teens, you know, who were serving out their sentences, and you just realize one bad decision can actually change the trajectory of your life. And then I got more serious about what would I do to make sure that we were all trying to figure out life together.
Yeah.
That's kind of, in anything I ended up doing, that was the consistent tone behind it.
Did you make good coins there?
Big time.
Yeah?
Yes.
And that
my
set you up,
property
right?
Because I got before I was 21, which was a huge achievement for me. I was actually thinking about it the other day, Ukba. When you grow up in the setup that I did, we only had our own home that no other family is in the same space with us in our adulthood.
Yeah.
So the first home we lived in, it was Yohlulwa
ngedonga. Okay.
Then the one family is on the other side and you guys have to kind of create all your functional spaces in here. Then we moved from there to another space where it was a little bit bigger, but all the kids were in one room and my parents had their space and one passage toilet, that kind of set up. And I managed to buy my own place before my parents even moved out of that kind of situation. And so now to get to a space where they've got their own home, we now are property owners. That's a big deal for Umdosuka Etuja, who didn't even think my life would turn out anything like what it has. So I guess it becomes important for me to never forget that girl who is in a setup like trying to figure out, shucks, man, is this hard work going to be worth it?
Yeah.
Is me being different going to be worth it and putting up with being told you're not like the others?
Yeah.
Yes, it's going to be worth it. Like, am I going to one day see myself doing things I could never even have pictured at some stage in my life?
Right.
So, I don't know. It sometimes makes me seem as though I'm very serious, but I take that seriously.
I get
so it shows up in every part of my life.
Amazing.
I get that. And I think just like stepping back to something that you spoke about there as well in terms of like kind of doing things your way.
Yeah.
Let's talk about some of the major fights you've had to have like across your life around the mean you are not your hair.
Yeah.
Because you've had this hair for the longest time, and people like like in that space, TV space, in the, what's the word I'm looking for?
Entertainment and media space. Yeah,
aesthetic space, always just like, dreadlocks. Can you just tell us, take us through some of the fights that you've had to actually endure, like around
this? I think it was always just the general conversation that we should be different, allowed to be different, and respected for being different, no matter what that looked like.
Yeah.
I think initially people understood that I had an issue with people wearing weaves and wigs and all of that. That was never my conversation.
Yeah.
My conversation was, let's be equally accepted for how we want to show up. It, I suppose, got paralleled then with the hair conversation, because I suppose that's the easiest way for sometimes people to draw the point. But I wasn't a specific figure size either. I didn't just speak English. And it was strange to me ukuba xa uhlonipha umuntu omdala in entertainment ubeke isimaphambili uthi bhuti banibani tata banibani. I distinctly remember someone saying to me, no, you don't say that to Hugh. Go humor, sikela, niyalingana ngoku. That blew my mind. I was like, that makes no sense to me as an African child growing up in some of the ways that I've been taught. Doesn't matter where I go. Ungazumbize ngegama wena umuntu omdala. So it was constantly that idea of, that's okay for you to think that's fine for you, but don't look down on me that this is how I choose to do it. So that was the running conversation.
Were there ever any job offers that were put to you and they said you can get this job on condition that you change your
hair? Two specific ones. I wouldn't say on, that's a bit tacky though.
It's in the like, don't say the name. Just say, you know, there was a bag for 200K that I had to say no to.
I mean, it was two specific situations. The one said, we just need you to lose a little bit of weight. And the one was like, this is what the styling of your hair will be.
Yeah.
I don't know where I got the guts to say no to that, but I said no to that. Because I think any decision that I make, sometimes it's been bad decisions. Sometimes I've messed up. And I had to specifically be saved in one incident because I'd messed up. But I want to be able to stand behind that it was my decision, it was my choice.
Right.
Like, so those two, without a doubt, I was like, ain't nobody going to tell me what to do with my body, first off. And I'm not going to go against what I believe in so that it makes sense to you. Because then what do I account for? What am I responsible for?
Right.
I can't be telling people it's okay to be this way, but oh no, just compromise yourself on certain days and for certain bags. Because I think I've always guarded that once in my mind I start chasing the bag, I've lost the underlying reason behind what I do, And I've done it differently. It's taken me longer in many instances to get into certain spaces and to be seen for what I'm able to bring. I am a fantastic team player, even if I do say so myself. But sometimes you work a little harder to get people to understand that. But I don't think there's any team I've ever contributed to where they will say, well, the person who wasn't pulling their weight was that one. So that I can be proud of. And there's certain spaces I didn't get the opportunity to be in. It works out in the long run. Because, Jonga, listen to me. Ndifuna iklema. It decision in the tati layer.
I love
always.
Owning it.
There's this thing, ultimate confidence. And you ooze it so much.
Oh, for real?
It's amazing. Because no one can ever come to you and say, oh, you're a shit presenter. You'll be like, cool, that's your opinion. But is it my reality? No. Because I know I'm dope.
Like,
you know what I mean? Like,
so
I'm doping my way. Whether you like it or not, that's on you.
It's so crazy because I would not have done Umhlobo Wenene, which I've actually done for 8 years now, if I had listened to people who said I wasn't going to be able to do that.
Yeah.
I look back on some, and this is the thing, like, many of the things we have done, we're not standing on a mountain screaming and shouting about what we've been able to do. Never being involved in the awards industry for the media and marketing space. I've hosted the Louis with people like Rian Krewagen. I mean, with Johan Stemmert, David Hasselhoff. I co-hosted with Thibaut Touch the Metro FM Awards. I've never worked for Metro FM. So when you dig deep into some of our stories, those of us who've been working diligently and consistently and hard, don't take away what we've earned and worked for
right.
just because we're not standing in front of the crowd saying, hey, yo, this is what's
this.
Up, right?
Yeah.
Just give respect where respect is due.
Yeah.
And that's the important thing, I think.
100%.
Yeah.
Big up to that. So I want to go back to being a team player and why I laugh so hard.
Yeah.
So we were in a team once. Together, playing 30 seconds.
Okay.
Right? Are you going to go there? Why are you like this?
When you say ultimate confidence, man,
yeah.
fighter. Like, you've seen me play 30 seconds
yeah,
and
yeah.
how, like, I get into it.
Yeah.
Another level altogether. To the point where she doesn't play games anymore.
Yeah, I
she's
don't.
Just like,
welcome to my world.
She's I like, can't play them competitively anymore. I realize
I
that I value
games,
my
period.
Friendships.
I don't play games, period, because of that.
No.
Like, it's too much. Like, it's like what I did with sport.
Yeah.
yeah.
I decided to support one team and one
and
team
it.
Only.
Yeah.
Because there was a weekend where I had like, oh no, I support this, this and that.
Yeah.
And they all lost.
Just too
much. No. I can deal with one and my focus is on that.
Yeah.
So with games as well, I'm like, I can't do this. Like,
yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah.
I want to come back a little bit maybe to the ultimate confidence thing, because
yeah.
I think there's a pre-story that is
right.
always important to bring
Let's
to
learn.
The conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah. And sometimes you have to self-talk and sometimes you go, but really, is no one gonna see consistently that I'm able to do this, or I'm ready for this, or this is how I could do it and it would add value? There's a level you get to when you allow yourself to
yeah.
process the things that you sometimes feel insecure about,
yeah.
that you go, I'm gonna make a decision and be resolved about it. I'm gonna be determined and never let anyone or anything make me feel like this particular point ever again.
Right.
Yeah.
When you protect that boundary,
yeah.
you start to like manifest more of that confidence,
yeah.
because then you're not governed emotionally by someone else's response
yeah.
to
right,
what
right,
it is
right.
you're trying to bring to the table.
Yeah.
There's an internal knowingness. And that you keep working on, because as you keep growing, go through life, you know, dust yourself off for some hectic falls that you make along the way. That's why I advocate for therapy. If there's one person who speaks their heart, it's me.
Yeah.
If you're in my friendship circle, we're doing it all the way, or we're not doing it at all. Because I want people who want to be around me to be healthy.
Yeah.
I prioritize myself being healthy, so I work on that.
Right.
So I can continue to protect that boundary.
It's very important. I think that is something I take a lot from you. Like, you don't mind having the difficult conversations.
Yeah.
No matter what the setting.
Yeah.
Like, ngabe senkwari nakubizele site na. So itheta
le.
You know, and I appreciate that. I think when I say we, let me not even say we, I think men in general, we don't know how to have those conversations. I'm learning now how to have the difficult conversations. I mean, I had to take a step back and look at things. I mean, I've always had one way of looking at things, which was survive. How do you survive?
Mm.
If you get fever, you got to get up the next day and fight again.
Yeah.
But I'm fighting again, but I haven't dealt with what happened.
That's right.
So I keep bottling it up and. So it's a lot of new learnings, and it's a very important thing also that plays a role in mental health issues.
Yeah.
Because now we can become better by making sure you're okay.
Yeah.
Makes it now a safe space for Spay to be able to talk to me, you to be able to open up to me, and that sort of thing. So
I
it's
have
very
to say
critical.
That also for, in as long as the time is that I've known you guys, I actually really vibe with the fact that we're actually at a stage where, just in general, we can start to be more mature as adults about the roles that we play in each other's lives as guys and girls, interacting even in friendships. Mm. I think I've started to witness you guys be a lot more open about what the real stuff is that we're dealing with, and vice versa.
Right.
And often all you need is just that other perspective.
Yeah.
Or sometimes all you need is just to be able to have said it and get it off your chest.
Yeah.
So I think the more we also appreciate the fact that we're grown now, we've been through some stuff, like we've seen life, let's just be real about how we can do this life that we've got well with each other, the people you choose to have in your space.
Yeah. Okay. And it's no perfect life. I mean,
no,
there are things that really irritate me, like really do, but I'm learning consistently, like a fly, you know? But I'm learning now that, like, there's more important things to focus on.
Yeah.
And if it's outside of the circle,
yeah,
leave it alone.
And owning up, being able to say, sorry, man, that's teaching me some serious lessons in being humble.
Yeah.
Saying sorry, because at some point you were the problem too, you know?
Indeed, yeah.
So.
Yeah.
With what you've just said in mind now, I'd like to just ask you, So in 2018, there was that unexpected post from you, because I didn't see it coming, like
right.
where you spoke about your past and sexual abuse issues there as well. What was behind the, or rather, where did you find the strength, you know, like within yourself to actually post that, knowing that then there's going to be spotlights and people asking questions and, you know, saying things that aren't any of your business and also be, kind of belittling something as big as that in your life. Where did you find the strength to actually decide to post that? And how did you find the support from just people in general, from all walks of life after that?
So what I had done before that was actually build myself up first.
Okay.
I'd been in therapy for an extensive period of time because I'd realized that the echoes of that trauma were still making decisions on my behalf, even at the stage of life I was at then. Mm. Because trauma that's unresolved shows up in some crazy ways.
Mm.
And sometimes some of the decisions you make are 100% self-destruction.
Mm. Right.
And then you look at it and you go, wait, what? What happened there? There's a deeper thing that you gotta unpack. So for me, I had been building up my emotional capacity to be able to know that when I'm ready, I would like to say it. This is how I'd like to say it. And this is the reason why I want to address it.
Yeah.
These numbers of GBV are out of control in our country.
Mm.
But the perception often has been it's a certain kind of person who experiences this.
Right.
And we go and a club full of people and 80% of those people can relate to that experience.
Yeah.
But because they don't proverbially look like what they've been through, we don't actually aggregate the problem to be as serious as it is. So for me at the time, I realized that I can stand behind this decision. I'm not even waiting for anyone to pat me on the back and tell me how brave I am, this, that, and the other. It was to say, I get you. And as much as I'm Zizel who does this for work, first and foremost, I'm a human.
Right.
And I'm at the level in my journey that I'm prepared to connect with you as humans more than I'm concerned about what that might impact my work perceptions.
Got that.
And I think we all started having very authentic conversations in and around the COVID period.
Yeah.
We were sick and tired of showing up with a mask, man.
Yeah.
It's heavy stuff.
Indeed.
It's
indeed.
Hectic.
I mean, we started on radio. We started and we gave it an hour on a Monday to talk about it because there was so much learning and unlearning that needed to be done. And I just hope, you know, a lot of the guys I would talk to offline would say, bro, you know, a lot of the things you guys discuss on the show, I didn't know, you know, this is what it meant because in where I grew up, this is normal.
Yeah.
You know, now to unlearn what I've known for 40 years becomes the most difficult thing.
It is hectic.
But it's important because I'm now a father.
Yeah.
I am a brother. I am. I need to teach.
And it always opens up a greater perspective for you to consider, even just as gents, for example.
Yes.
And I mean, in and around the club setup, ladies are freely flowing in and out. How do you behave in a way that makes them know you're actually just being a gentleman and you're not crossing the line?
Right.
You don't have another expectation. When you say you want to protect them, that's the long and the short of it, and there's no strings attached. Building environments where when we come to support you guys, we know we are safe there.
Yeah.
There's so many things that from the other perspective, it may not be a normal consideration, how we dress, who we have gone out with when we've gone out with. How many drinks can we have? Because is someone going to see that as an opportunity? Can I trust a drink that comes from Nate or Spit?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? All those dynamics that help you be mindful of how we conduct ourselves in and around each other's space. You may think, oh, just touching someone on the back, it's a standard procedure. You're just being gentle, you're showing protection. But if that's how my incident started and that's a trigger
it's
for
triggering.
Me, and in the middle of the situation, I'm now straight back to the point of my trauma. That's the important part about continuing to have conversations, be open about it, ask the questions, because we can't assume everybody just knows what the dynamics are or the nuances that follow that situation. Mm.
Having unpacked it before you even came out with it, how do you think it affected you in relationships and in the way that you relate to men in general?
This is 100% honest.
Yeah.
Coming out of my last session, I realized that deeply, 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 I have not had a 100% certainty that I can trust a man ever since that incident happened. And so to have realized that now, as a 33-year-old, you can only imagine the variety of ways that it has shown up in my interaction with any man, but also in a relationship that I may have been in.
Right.
So it's an ongoing thing. Mm. And that also is linked to me repairing the trust I have in self, because the question has often lingered, could I have had an instinct in that moment that perhaps I shouldn't have been where I was? Mm. An instinct that could have saved me if I'd been conscious enough to hear it.
Right.
But how do you have that conversation? I was a 9-year-old girl who expected that if I can trust you, I shouldn't have an instinct that says I'm in danger.
Ooh.
So that, it's an ongoing thing, and that's the God honest answer.
Yeah, I appreciate that as well.
So it has shown up not well.
It's very scary because it's a continuous, ongoing cycle where abo malume are protected, you know? Abo malume, it's like, hey, upo malume, zibingane.
Yeah.
Instead of actually dealing with umalume.
Yeah.
Because ingane kumele zibe free.
Yeah.
Masitheli so ingane ezidlala la jardin. Sazi ukuthi la kusekhaya.
Yeah.
Nothing must happen to you. It's like it's a friend of mine, Spears cousin Arnie, always says, "Mawungishayela ekhaya, uthi ngibaleke ngiyephi?"
Yeah.
You know? So if this is happening ekhaya, where am I going to run to?
Yeah.
Because ekhaya is supposed to be my safe haven.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I think this leads to a bigger conversation that needs to be had now around what we are experiencing, and also then kind of reconciling with that it takes a village to raise a child.
Yeah, mm.
We need to have a whole...
Definitely, yeah.
And it's some very courageous conversations that need to be had, because in as much as you guys need to understand our perspectives, we also need to be open to understand your perspectives.
Mm. Yeah.
It's almost somehow an understanding that because the issue is prevalent here, the solution comes from here. The solution starts by unpacking what informed why we are here.
Right, right.
Sometimes only you guys have access to that information in as much depth that would suddenly make us go, is that what they've been trying to say the whole time?
Right.
Because we make the assumption that it's easy to have a conversation. You fully understood what I've meant and I said, and vice versa. Meanwhile, there's an entire context that comes with me and vice versa. Mm. And then you go and do something. I'm like, but why would you go do that after I've just had the conversation with you?
Whereas I understood it completely differently.
And it's like almost the quickest example I can make is like doing a presentation.
Yeah.
Does your presentation have sufficient information for someone whose eyes are looking at it afresh to fully understand what's going on?
Right.
Because when you've been working on a presentation for long, because you know what it's supposed to say, you think it's clear, but it's not always the case.
Yeah.
Lit.
Okay.
Why do I always get dragged into the hectic conversation? I love chatting with you guys. Media? It's a love-hate relationship, if I can put it honestly.
Okay.
There's certain spaces in and around that I was just like, Jonga, and this uyipasalena into because in Bamba, I know. And as much as God is working on my heart, I have a pre-Jesus temper. And I don't know that I can.
Pre-Jesus temper,
right?
Okay.
I don't know that I can sit and listen to you speaking smack to me or about me or about someone that I care about
and
trust myself to keep my mouth shut. So the smartest thing for me to do is then just not go and play in that space. I don't know when the last time is I even bought a tabloid newspaper. I don't even know the last time when I went on the internet to go and search some stuff that's got nothing to do with what I need to be doing when I'm on the internet, simply because it's not a space I want to keep opening myself up to anymore. I've gotten to a stage where I'm like, yo, man, like, the legit people that know me and what my vibe is, I don't have to explain anything to
100%.
Them. Also because I decided it's the last time I have to sit my parents down and have a tough conversation with them about sensitizing them to something that they have to deal with that is laced with just malice, to put it
pure malice.
Mildly, right? So, yeah, I just don't think that side of me wants to be prevalent. I really enjoy my life now and how I'm running things.
Yeah.
And following on from that question, I mean, we are all the better now for those Sunday sessions at 10 a.m.
Hectic.
Like where you share your faith with us. And it, like, I think it's such an enriching moment to actually find time to get in there with you, because you go into so much depth and you can see how it talks to you even at the same, like same time. And when you're also reading people's comments, how different interpretations of the gospel talk to you and how literally it affects you. So when you did that, did you find that at all you started kind of confusing your following just in terms of general people and also maybe even from a corporate point of view?
That's an interesting point. If everyone is allowed to show up for what they believe in, this is what I believe in.
Right.
It shouldn't impact my ability to do my work. If you understood the package and accepted it only if it came in one way, anything that limits my ability to grow is not something I want in my space.
Right.
And so if someone can see me advocating for my faith and think that that is something that's unattractive to them, I can respect their decision to make a different choice about it.
Yeah.
But I'm always going to grow. Growth is a priority for me.
Lovely.
A second part to that was the reality of life, man. Like, we all have been raised under specific faith, say, maybe we grow up and we change and we decide we want to follow this one or that thing. But ultimately, predominantly, most of us feel that we do need something that grounds us fundamentally.
Yeah.
And I was starting those sessions just unpacking some of what I've misunderstood about my faith, trying to find, is God relevant to me?
Right.
What do I need to know about this homie for myself?
Right.
And what does what he has to teach me apply to 2022, I've got 2022 problems. Is the Bible still relevant to 2022? And then it became, is anyone else interested in having this conversation with me? I'm pretty sure I'm not the only one who has some of these challenges. I'm pretty sure I'm not the only one who's felt judged by the teachings. I'm pretty sure I'm not the only one who's felt like I need something beyond myself. And I just started having those conversations as honestly as I could have. In the context of what I'm learning, what it means to me, does it help someone else? And it doesn't stop me from being a kick-ass MC.
Yeah,
I am very good at what I do.
So you're a good MC, right?
I am, indeed.
You're also a good MC.
Yeah.
You're also a pastor's kid, right? You're also a pastor's kid. Do you guys see where I'm going with this?
No.
You're as Vuleni Swan.
And you and you'd be the treasurer.
You specifically want to be the treasurer.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Mina I'll focus on calling him out. Mina Shumayalani.
Okay,
all right. And then just in terms of you being the personality that you are and just there's always going to be a spotlight on your life. How have you managed to kind of keep away certain personal developments in your life away from the spotlight and just not talking about them at all?
You just make a decision. You just make a decision. What's the most sensible way for me to deal with this situation?
Yeah.
And a lot of times the most difficult thing to do, which is to keep your mouth shut, is the very thing that you need to do. I don't think anyone who's impacted by any decisions that I'm making isn't aware of what's going on.
Yeah.
Abanye abantu baze spectator, Joe. And you can decide to not have that be a situation.
Yeah.
You can make that decision.
Because that's it's your life, right? And if you want to watch my life, you're going to watch what I give you. You know, if I don't want you to see this. I'm not going to show it to you.
Yeah. Yeah. The other part of it, and I loved, it's so strange. I was scrolling through Insta, came across a caption that Ukefi Boo wrote.
Yeah.
And she said, it's not a secret, it's just not your business.
Yeah.
Oof. And that resonated.
Yeah.
Because it's like we've become so like focused on performing.
Yeah.
We got to live up to the grab. Yes. We got to live up to the streets. We got to live up to the dun-dun. Then suddenly you're making yourself accountable to people who should not be accountable for things that are going on in your space and in your life. Yeah. So you can make the decision. As difficult as it is, keep your mouth quiet. Might as well speculate about.
Yeah, it is difficult. Because like sometimes you want to like clear the air because you're like, you're talking absolute BS.
You will never be able.
How did you get there?
Because once the story is out, it's out. And then like...
Yeah, but what if it's absolute BS? Like, for example, a tabloid puts you on the front page with something that's completely fabricated. Do you not want to clear the air at all?
Like, but you know, the thing is this, like, if someone is determined about what they want the situation to be, you're not going to convince that person otherwise. You can only rely on the fact that the consistency of character you have had, having to live your life to some extent in front of the public eye, that integrity stands you in good ground. That's the only thing you've got to rely on. That's why, like, you work for your name because it's important to you, not because you're offsetting against somebody else. Yeah. And if at this stage you don't know my character, I mean, there's not much more I can do beyond that.
What's the best thing about being a mom?
The best thing about being a mom is watching your kids grow from milestone to milestone. Oh, it's making me teary.
Yeah.
They're, like, seeing them at a stage where they need you for everything to... You've played a part to teach them to be able to do it on their own. And then growing to stand back and let them do it on their own and figure it out. And the co-parenting relationship, which I love so much because everyone has a valuable thing to throw into the mix.
Right.
And it's not my way or the highway. It's like, what can I learn about their contribution and vice versa?
Yeah.
My kids are everything.
How many kids do you want to have in total?
I would probably sneak in one more, potentially, but not anytime soon.
I pray God just like surprises you with
No, I don't want to be surprised. But deep in doesn't to be surprised.
I love the best, like, one day, you know, but I know this feeling.
I'm not feeling well.
I'm not feeling well. And by then, you know, would you surprise?
No. I'm loving the age that they're at now.
Yeah.
Their independence, Ekoyo, just the brotherhood as well.
Yeah.
They drive each other crazy, but they don't want anyone to get into the mix of their whole
this
dynamic.
This is us. We are
licking the hashtags.
Loving
that. Yeah. So I love it. Yes. That's the best thing
surprise
about being a mom.
Surprise coming your way.
No, thanks.
You know something that we don't?
I don't start with that. Moving right along.
I'm just like he keeps pressing the points. I'm like, because I don't know anything. Does he know something that we don't?
Listen, I'm certainly not going to be surprised, and it's certainly not on the plans just to have that clear.
You see, this is what I'm saying. Like, it's. Someone going to tell us?
No, I'm sitting here with you.
Yeah, let's not project that.
I'm not projecting anything. I'm just saying.
What are the chances? Maybe you have a surprise.
I'm vasectomied up. Okay?
Enough with the surprises.
I'm done with the surprises.
You're done.
I'm finished.
No more Merry Christmas in
closed.
June.
Closed.
Let me tell you the story very quickly.
Tell me.
We had, what do you call it?
Psychic.
A psychic on our radio show on Kaka CFM.
Yes.
And he still had one kid then, and she was like, yo, and you're gonna have three kids.
Yes!
And he was like, what? How many kids is he on now? Three kids.
But I've also decided I'm not gonna ask psychic questions anymore. I don't wanna know.
You would rather just have it roll up on
you. The surprise.
But now you make sure that it can't be a
surprise. No, I'm done.
I'm
at the end of the road.
But kids are dope. Those little people change your life.
They do.
Yeah,
they change your life, right?
They change your bank balance too.
Then there's that, but you must work harder. And then there's that.
They must get jobs.
I agree.
They will eventually.
Okay. Yeah. Actually, On that note, with getting jobs, and with everything that you have access to, have you possibly also made a conscious decision maybe not to have the kids start in the industry early? Has no one knocked at your door and said, yeah, this kid is program, this kid is campaign?
I mean, we've done a little bit of one or two things, but it's always been guided by their willingness to participate. I don't force them to be involved. On some days, they're like, Ma, we really don't actually want to be on camera. So the other day, VK goes, Mom, is this really going to be out there for everyone? So I go, well, do you give me permission or do you not? He says, no. So I said, okay, then mommy won't put it up. Then I don't put it up. But Uaka's at that stage where he loves it. Mommy, look at me. And he wants to record. Yeah. So I just kind of gauge it with what they want to do because it must be fun for them and it mustn't feel tedious for them.
That's cool.
That. I would be open to it. We would be open to it. But it would depend.
Mine gets sent packages, right?
Yes.
They get sent all the stuff.
Yeah.
And then my daughter will dress up and say, Daddy, you don't take enough photos with us.
Okay.
So they're not going to send you anything. Take more photos.
Take get more photos. Stuff. They'll send more stuff.
Look at me.
She's figured it out.
She's got it.
Okay. Right. So looking at some of the work that you do, every year you are involved somehow, be it emceeing, be it presenting an award at the Feathers. So I wanted to ask you because there's this one caption you had like on this 1 year and you said our community.
Yeah.
And you had me now asking questions.
Yeah.
I think
I've always loved Tami and I've always supported Tami.
Never invites me. After making us couple of the year this one year. Then after that, no invitations.
Yeah. We'll speak to him to invite you guys.
I see him all the time. I saw him in the spot where I was like, all right, Tami, I'm getting an invitation this year.
And I'm definitely this is a tricky one in the sense that people are also gonna say, oh, but the Bible says and stuff.
No.
I'm an ally and primarily we are to love God's people. Right. So in that capacity, I'll always show up for Tami. That's my homie, for real, for real.
Yeah.
Tami is one of those friends who we met instantly, we vibed instantly. Tami has been with me through some hectic stuff in both each other's lives.
Yeah.
And so if Tami needs me to do something, no questions asked, I show up and Amazing. That's that. Yeah.
That's all, man. That's all we need in a friend, right?
Yeah.
I need you to show up at my weakest and I need you to show up at my best.
Absolutely.
But most importantly, I just need you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
You're deep sometimes.
Oh, you can be, and I like it.
Damn.
I like it when you let us see that side of yourself. Did I push it?
So
okay?
We like it, but he doesn't like it when we see that side of it. That is so crazy. Okay, so now that you have more time on your hands, because we are both not doing afternoon radio anymore, well, all three of us.
Yeah.
So the country, I don't know how the country feels about that. What are you filling it up with? Because I know that like you are a go-getter and you still have a lot of things to tick off.
So also the other thing is sometimes people think what they see you do is the extent of what you do.
Right.
So I've got businesses behind the scenes that have kept going and are going to continue to go.
Right.
I think now this space gives me an opportunity. I've been wanting to focus more on the after-school stuff with the kids, their homework stages, getting into bed, reading the stories, because they're only small for such a period of time.
Right.
And I think in and around that, then I will increase my availability to do the other things, sort of like the emceeing and the appearances. Because I haven't done that in a while. I haven't been social in a while, so I kind of want to enjoy some of that as well.
Yeah.
But I'm so excited for the things that are on, you know, the come up, but also just the chance to rest.
Yeah.
I'm discovering and starting to practice rest as a discipline because often we calculate our value on our productivity.
Yes.
But the rest is a big part of our ability to be productive. Yeah. So for the next little while, that's going to be my focus. But otherwise, my businesses are still going.
Yeah, I have a friend. We have a friend, Leon. He said he did a calculation on his life.
Yeah.
And he said he spends so much time in his bed and finds that as the best place for him.
Yeah.
That instead of going to go buy a million-rand car, he went and bought an 800,000-rand bed.
Yeah.
And he's like, he rests peacefully every single night.
Yeah. Because you find your pocket of happiness, ne?
Yeah.
I like
100%.
That. I like that. For me, I love very early mornings when everyone is still sleeping. Mm. The sun hasn't quite come up yet and it's cold and crispy outside. I like to sit outside and just have some breathing room. And
I'm okay with the like 4:30. It's just the cold and crispy.
I love that.
Nah. I thought it was you getting off your couch and finally going to bed. That after
Don't be ugly.
So big up to you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me, you guys.
I wish we could talk for long, like I know we can, but we got to wrap it right here. Like time is up. So yeah, wishing you all the best.
I've got to say before you say all the nice things you're supposed to say about me.
That what?
That you guys are super dope humans. You never say that enough about yourselves, but for the group of people that I've come to know, as a result of knowing you guys, you are pretty solid. You have an army of people that would, at a drop of a hat, show up for you, no matter what you needed. I think it is important to also give honor where you find those friendships that stand the test of time. And if you don't hear it often enough, it's not because it's not felt. And you guys are so dope. I just wanted to publicly honor you that for that, actually. Yes,
before Stalu Kala, Ngcela Serap.
Okay.
But can I tell a quick story?
Way, Nazo.
It is. No, like just like as testimony. She ain't lying. There was this one time we found ourselves in a situation where like an ex of mine was in the place to be and they were starting to talk smack in my ear. Guess who rolled up? She was like, are you okay? And you? That's your story. And that was the end of that. I was like, what just happened? So when she says that, she'll show up for her people. And we have an army of support behind us.
Yeah. Fully
that's why I don't have exes.
Nah.
Nobody gonna be, you know.
Out of the whole story, that's what he picks up.
Okay. Right.
It can only be names and gossip.
And we'll definitely be knocking on your door again because you're going to make some amazing moves. We're putting it out there in the world and you're going to come and sit here and tell us all about them.
Thank you, Jay.
Yeah, bro.
That's that. We'll see you in the next one. The King's Cast with Spectacular and DJ Names.